earlier at the first reading of my relief at the U-turn that had been taken by the government on prohibiting the use of information from animal testing to approve an application for the use of psychoactive substances. And how essentially that proposal was in essence the same as the amendment that I put up to the Psychoactive Substances Bill a year ago. I would like to take an opportunity to just thank all the parties that voted in support of that amendment, which included the Labour Party, in particular Trevor Mallow's hard work on that, John Banks and Mana and Maori parties. And I also spoke about the shocking process that the bill went through, whereby all the voices of the animal welfare organisations and people speaking out against the use of animal testing to approve these drugs were rejected by the chair of the Health Select Committee. And so what I would like to do is to actually go through the report that we produced as a result of the hearing that we held. Because we held our own alternative hearing to hear these submissions that were excluded for having the right to the democratic say. And so there were a number of major organisations that spoke and presented to the submission. These included the SAFE, the SPCA, PUHA, the New Zealand Anti-Abuse Protection Society, as well as a number of individuals. And the first thing that actually most of the submitters said was to acknowledge the need for strong regulation of psychoactive substances. They accepted that the situation that existed at that time was not working, and they were welcoming the intent of the bill. And some of them even talked about their private lives and people that they knew that had been turned upside down by some of these drugs. Then a lot of them talked about their utter dismay that democratic process had not been followed, that they had made their submissions and done their research in the good faith that their concerns around animal testing would be heard by the Health Select Committee. And they were deeply, and they had done so under the recommendation of the Minister at the time and the health official. And so to then to be rejected was for them a deep betrayal of democratic process. And what they asked of them was a very detailed submission from the Anti-Vivisection Society. You see, what had happened was that right back 6 months previously, they had, under the Official Information Act, got hold of a report that had been produced by the Ministry of Health that outlined a proposed testing regime for these drugs. And at that point in time, the testing regime was to involve a number of stages. And there were the pre-clinical toxicology trials, and then the human clinical trials, as well as the post-registration surveillance. And it's quite important to understand that a testing regime composed of all these three elements. It was never proposed that a clinical trial would be able to prove safety to the point where it could go straight to being used on the general population. There were always also going to be human clinical trials involved. And this is something that the public often don't realise when they say, oh, we don't want animal testing, let's just go straight to testing them on drug addicts and so on. Actually, we need controlled studies, and they were always going to be part of the process with human volunteers. And they start with microdosing and monitoring very carefully for the clinical signs of reactions and so on. So whatever tests they use for the preclinical trials are designed to wean out the most toxic, the most likely to have extreme dangerous reactions. And the original Ministry of Health standard for safety, but actually safety isn't the right word to talk about the whole testing regime. It's about low risk, because actually you cannot prove that any drug, any recreational drug, is safe. Alcohol is not safe, tobacco is not safe, and yet we use them and we accept the risk that comes with their use. So it's always going to be about trying to rule out the... Can I go over?
Roger Mathers.
Yes, please. Thank you. It's always going to be about trying to screen out the most damaging of these drugs, and then focusing on the lowest drugs and then educating the public about their use. And the reality is that the Ministry of Health's initial proposed testing regime included four types of testing: for acute toxicity, for repeat dose toxicity, for toxicokinetic investigation, and for genotoxicity. And for all four of these, there are validated alternatives to animal testing, not just one or two, but three or four or more. And all of them have been validated. That means that they have been demonstrated to be so as good, if not better, results than those of the animal equivalent animal trials. So I utterly reject the claim by Paul Hutchinson that we are being somehow found of unscientific or airy-fairy or what have you. That's not the case. There are established internet studies on these areas. The reality is that report, which was commissioned by the Anti-Resistance Society by using an overseas expert, because we don't have the expertise in New Zealand, and that is the problem. The New Zealand is small. The country of only a few million people. We don't have all of the... We're not experts in alternative to animal testing. The experts are overseas. We have to rely on overseas input in this area to achieve the goal of low-risk products that have been tested by using non-animal tests. We can do it, but we must look overseas for the expertise and the tests involved. Thank you.
Esanati Lawley Taylor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I